been thatching for, I started 30 years ago, carpenter by first trade. I started actually just down the road from where we are today, building a reconstructed Iron Age village. And 30 years ago we started cutting water reed to thatch the roof with, and I've continued doing it every year since. And so I still do carpentry, but mostly thatching nowadays. Yeah, well, years ago we started cutting water reed, and we just thought, you know, I love doing it. But I've found over the years of using imported water reed, because obviously, you know, most thatchers pick up the phone, there's our big reed suppliers that'll just arrive at the bottom of your scaffolding. Couldn't get it easier. But, I mean, with what I do is obviously slightly more difficult way. There's a saying, what grows in the wet lasts in the wet, as far as thatching material goes. And I used to think that was a bit of a nonsense, but an actual fact, thinking about it, when some of these reeds that come from these very hot countries, they grow at a phenomenal rate in the growing season, and they don't seem to last. Some of the imported reed is not lasting anything like some of the harder types of reed that comes from, for instance, Norfolk. But there's reed from Newport Estuary on a roof just down the road. It's been there 30 years and it's still doing really well. So I'm very encouraged with local produce. But again, we go back to this a local material used to being in the environment where it's going to be used. And that seems to make a big difference, a bigger difference than you might think. It's not just a wives' tale. When I started 30 years ago, because this is my 30th cut in this Newport rebed, 1982, so 30 years. When I started years ago, not that many people were that clued up with what I was doing. I used to get a bit of flack, really, you know, whoa, where are the birds going to live? And, you know, actually it grows back every year, even stronger. It thrives with regular cutting, it goes back really well. And of course we don't cut it all at once, we do it in rotation. So the birds move over there, this year we cut this bit and next we do that bit. So we are very careful what we do, and all the conservation bodies now are in accord that it's good practice, it's the sort of thing you want to do. Years ago when I started cutting, we used to cut with one of these, this sort of thing, a sickle, and it used to take approximately six days to cut by hand. And then of course, you know, you've got to tie them up yourself, so you've got to bend down, tie them up, carry them out on your shoulder, you know, all the way to the roadside. 6 guys, 6 days. I think the most tiring bit was walking out with it on your shoulder, because it's muddy, you see, and the mud tries to pull your willies off. You know, to get a whole trailer load of reed cut by hand is a massive undertaking. The first year we used the reaper binder with a quad bike, from beginning to cut to actually having the whole crop in a barn, 6 hours. Yeah, it is breathtaking. What it does mean is that this little machine runs on biodiesel. It's the most efficient way of cutting reeds, right? And we can sustainably, year after year, go into a reserve, maintain it, and really manage it in an efficient way, which means we can more realistically do a long-term plan, which means we're really more serious about sustainability. The reed's really valuable. I mean, it goes on prestigious jobs. I've been using it on all sorts of new build, eco-type homes over the last few years. Yeah, 30 years. 30 years I've been cutting this, so I'm quite chuffed today, really.